hugely important job. But it's just stuff you need to know. Now, the rest of you all are already clerks. How long have the rest of you all already, who are already clerks, been clerks?
30 years.
Then you need to be doing this and not me.
1 year, but it was before a lot of these changes.
Okay, all right.
I've actually, this is my second. I did it for 6 years, yeah.
Okay, so.
I've been it for 6 years, but it's just been the past month that I've been writing things. Like, I'm supposed to do that?
Yeah. Okay. And unfortunately, a lot of. We think we know everything that we're supposed to do, but this is a big job, and probably has gotten. I won't say bigger, but we've gotten less detailed because our new wonderful form of government, which gives a whole lot of flexibility, doesn't put a lot of details in there. And so you have to do a lot of it with tradition and a lot of it with institutional memory and a lot of it with a variety of things. Totally off the subject. Everybody bring their book of order today? Oh, major mistake. Don't go to anything involved with a clerk that you don't have this. But I have to just point this out. Laura and I were talking about this. My grandfather was the clerk of session in Pollocksville for 20 years, and this is the Book of Order in 1954. I wish. And if for no other reason, it's got the right language in it. It's got a good normal language. But anyway, always have your book. Alright. So with some thanks to someone else who provided some training, I do have some other handouts that we'll give out, but let's get through this. Alright, what do we want to accomplish? You know, what makes a good clerk? Well, all of you are wonderful people because you have been elected, but we want to talk about that. We want to talk about the duties, what the book says. And what it doesn't say, one of the rest of you already said, I found out there's all sorts of stuff I'm supposed to be doing and I didn't know I'm supposed to be doing it. Well, the book doesn't say it, but you kind of are. Relationship with your pastor, very important, hugely important. Taking good minutes, what needs to go in, what needs to say, maintaining your roles, the dreaded annual statistical report. How many of you already done that? It's due the 28th, so we need to get it right. Other things, the presbytery, resources, and
22nd.
22nd, okay. Now, these are the things that I put up here based on what you all told Kay you wanted out of training session. So if we blow through all this and there's stuff that you want to know, there's someone else who's been here doing the clerk business as long as I have, so I think we can figure it out. Okay. Easy sneezy. To be a clerk, you've got to be an elder. How many of you all are on the session in active service for which you are serving as clerk? So there are several of you who are the clerk but are not serving. I personally think that's the way to go.
I am serving. I'm on the chair.
Okay. Yes, I think that's a one. I don't say that you should. There's a lot to be said about some continuity about being the clerk. And the other thing is, the last thing you need to do is deal with the clerk's job and also have to be chair of worship or chair of this or whatever, because you're involved in a lot of things. But anyway, you don't have to be active. You need to be knowledgeable about what the session does, and that requires your book of order. You need to be knowledgeable about what presbytery does and what Presbyterian polity is all about. You need to be able to write promptly, underscore the word promptly, what happened at your meeting. I don't know about you all, but my handwriting gets cold. And I have yet to learn to do like this lady and sit here and probably take her notes on an iPad. I still am of the old fountain pen and 8.5 by 14 the other legal pad. That's the way I took notes in college. That's the way I do things now. But I'm telling you, it gets cold. So write it all down quickly and maintain your roles and registers. So that doesn't sound so tough, but anyway. Okay. G30104, this is what it says you're to do. Record the transactions, keep the roles and of membership, maintain the registers, preserve the records carefully, furnish extracts to those records to hire counsel. Talk a minute, we're going to talk about several. Let me talk to you about preserving your records. How many of you all either are in possession of your church's sessional records or know that they are probably in Great Aunt Sue's closet or in a storage room in the church somewhere? Do you know where your sessional records are?
Yes.
Have you microfilmed them or microfiched them? Well, I'm going to plead some problems with Pollitt's. Well, we've got everything microfilmed through 81. We need to do the rest of it, because the thing about it is the books for up to 81 take up about six reels of about six frames of microfilm, and everything from 81 on would probably take up 100, because we write more, we keep more paper. Microfilm or microfix is the way to do it. I did some investigating. Don't think that because you're saving it on a computer or saving it on a disk is going to work. I can tell you for a fact that I set up a program using the old Works database to help keep some of my church records. It don't transfer to PowerPoint or Excel like normal things would. And so what you may save in Windows 97 might not open in 2010 or whatever. So don't think you can save it in perpetuity. And,
now, when you talk about microfiche or microfilm, you're talking about up in Raleigh. I know that. Is that where you're speaking of?
Well, you can get it done there. The Presbyterian Historical Society in Philadelphia will do it. And my angst on that, I don't have any problem with them doing it. I just have problems with getting it to them. And I'm just feeling I have to make a trip to Philadelphia. Gosh darn. have to figure out a way to do that. Back in the old days when we did it at Montreat, it was a whole lot easier to... when someone was going to youth conference or choir conference to take your books and get them later. But the denominational historical society will do it better and cheaper. I just wanted to put that out. If you don't know where your records are, find them and take those efforts to take care of them. Okay. I pulled this from a handbook from another presbytery. We're going to be talking about ours later because ours is very good. But I put you the various responsibilities with the Book of Order citations to make sure that we know. And the first five are things that we've already talked about, and those are the things that are in the book. Accurate record, the membership, the preservation of the records, the extracts of the minutes, and preserving the roll. But then you also need to be in charge of the Board of Deacons or the trustees, if your trustees are separate. If you have separate Board of Deacons, I mean, you need to be the one that not keeps those minutes, but needs to know where they are. So if you don't know where they are, you might want to go back and find out. You need to be familiar with the powers of the session. You need to know what you can, what the session, the body that you serve as clerk for, can do, and it is a pretty powerful council. We call them now. We call them governing bodies, and we call them judicatories, and we call them whatever. Where we're now a council, and you have a lot of say so. You need to know what those limits are. You're the person that needs to make sure that the congregation and the session are notified of meetings. Let me ask this. How many of you all are in churches that have a secretary? Ah, not many. Welcome to the secretarial world, clerks. That's what we have to do if we don't have a paid or volunteer secretary. There's always someone that can do that kind of stuff, but you're the one that's got to make sure that the announcements for meetings get in the bulletin, that the notifications are at the right time, that we call a congregational meeting and announce it appropriately, because if it happens to be something pretty controversial, someone could always come back and say, you didn't give proper notice. We didn't hear about it. Best thing you can do is just make sure you've covered all your bases. The annual statistical report, you see, that's not in the book. That's not in the book. And for those of us who are not computer savvy, it can be a little daunting, but I've got some stuff on that, and we'll talk about that. The minute book. Ah, yes. Taking it to presbytery. You didn't want to go to presbytery anyway. Best thing to do is give it to your pastor and let him or her take it. Turn it in and bring it back, and you get the little sticker. And we'll talk about that process. So serve as the secretary for the meetings of the congregation. Did you know that? And this is one thing that I noticed in somewhere when I was reading some minutes. They said they elected so-and-so. I said, no. I said, the clerk of session always serves as clerk of a congregational meeting unless the clerk can't be there. So there's no need in going through the motions of electing a clerk. You have a clerk by constitution. Bring all the correspondence and respond. This is a cool one. Keep a list of Keep a list of old and unfinished business. Keep a list. I messed that up. Got that right. We usually forget, and someone needs to keep up with it. And if you have an absent-minded professor, pardon the word, absent-minded pastor, professor, he or she may forget. They may think they remember everything. Younger ones have a tendency to think everything can go in the iPad. Older ones have a tendency to write it on a piece of paper, stick it in their pocket. They all forget. Someone needs to remind them. Be prepared to answer questions on parliamentary procedure. I can talk about that later. Receive communications. Notify the state clerk and changes of the membership. Assist the moderator and assist the pastor. Okay. Bottom line, though, folks, is you serve as the executive officer. Don't necessarily think of yourself as Tim Conway from McHale's Navy, but you are the second in command. You're second in charge. You're confident to the pastor. You're not just a secretary. And this is crucial when you do not have an installed pastor. How many of you all are in churches now that has no installed pastor? You have a stated supply or a temporary supply. Okay, a bunch of you. So you're the one. 99 times out of 100, when something goes wrong, they're going to look for the clerk. The letters come to the clerk. Your moderator, if Laura is serving as the moderator of a church without a pastor, if Stuart is serving as the moderator, I mean, they got 1,000 other things to do, and they blow in to moderate a session meeting. You've got to be able to talk with them or whoever your person is. Give you a good example of how people start to think about it. Two Sundays ago, I was at the Bethel Church, wherever, over here near Beulah. And got back home, and my wife said, oh, well, you missed some great excitement. I said, what happened? She said, well, our minister, who for the first time in my life is young enough to be my son, so you know I'm getting older. He, right after he read his sermon, read his scripture, he kind of started holding his chest at age 29. He said, I'm really, really feeling bad. Someone needs to take me to the hospital. Turned out to be some kind of acid reflux type thing. And he just kind of left. I mean, everything. And somebody turned around and said, where's the clerk? Well, the clerk was at Bethel. someone stepped in and took over. My point being is the first person someone thinks of is the clerk. If you happen to be in a place where there's a church secretary, I guarantee you the first person they're going to call when the pastor isn't around is the clerk. So you just need to be aware of that.